Welcome, this is Anna, and we are going to be looking at part one of unit 11, where we're going to look at the upper GI tract of the digestive system. So looking at the entire digestive tract, we're going to go ahead and we're going to divide it into the alimentary canal and the accessory organs. Okay. So the alimentary canal is going to be a tube that goes from mouth to anus. It's one continuous tube, although the epithelial tissues are going to change, and so will some of the structures of the supportive connective tissues in response to the particular function of that part of this tube. Okay, so you're going to learn all the different parts. So you've got your, technically we start with the oropharynx and then go into the esophagus, and that goes down. Esophagus passes through the gastroesophageal sphincter created by the diaphragm muscle into the stomach, then into the small intestines, and then into the colon, okay, rectum, and then anus. Excuse me, rectum and anus. I need to put that down. That's the sigmoid colon right there. Okay. Now the accessory organs are going to be your salivary glands. So you see those up there. We've got three paired salivary glands that you need to know. We've also got the liver and the gallbladder and the pancreas. Now you'll notice that I've color-coded things so that it's easier to pick them out. Now the spleen, I've historically chucked it into this unit to re-emphasize because it's right back there. And it's easy to see with the other abdominal organs that we're going to be studying. So it's going to be popping up, and you want to make sure you know that it's the spleen and not the kidney and not the stomach and so forth. All right, next slide. All right, if you do not remember your body cavities, you need to go back and re-memorize them. They are important. All right, so this is giving you the definitions of all those cavities. All right, if you don't quite remember all of your serosa stuff, this is the definitions. This is all, most of it is review from AMP1, okay? So we're gonna call the serosa in the abdominal pelvic cavity peritoneum. If it's going around an organ, it's visceral. If it's going up onto the walls of the abdominal cavity, it is called parietal. Now, we have special peritoneum that gets a different name because it is structurally different from the rest of the peritoneum. Mesentery, you take a double layer of visceral, not parietal, but visceral peritoneum, and you fold it over like a sandwich. In the middle of that, you're going to have a route for vessels, nerves, lymphatic vessels, and stuff like that, okay? Mesentery is connecting the abdominal wall organs to the wall, meaning it's anchoring it so it doesn't float around all over the place, as well as providing a route for stuff to get to and from them, okay? Then we've got two special types of mesentery, because, you know, it's not special enough. The lesser omentum, which goes between the liver and the stomach, and then the greater omentum, which is very noticeable because it hangs down like an apron from your transverse colon over the rest of your intestines. Okay, and we're going to look at pictures of these. All right, so right here, they've taken the liver, all right, and they've kind of pulled it back a little bit. Where's my... Can you see that? I think you can see it. And you can see the lesser omentum, which is going between the liver and the stomach and kind of holding them in place. Okay. And then the greater omentum is flopping down over from the stomach over the transverse colon and then going over all of the intestines right in here. All right, next slide. Okay, now these are pictures that people struggle with. I really like this slide right here, which is showing you this mid-sagittal section, so that you can see the organs and how they anchor to the wall. Let's actually look over at this one first because it's a little bit easier. And what they've done is they've taken the greater omentum and they've flipped it up over onto the chest, okay? Now you can see that transverse colon right there. And you can see an example of mesentery here, which is anchoring to the back wall here and the intestines here. And then you can also see that there's a bunch of stuff going through it. So all of the intestines will have mesentery wrapped around it, anchoring it to that back wall. Okay. Now let's do the harder picture. So right here, that's your liver. Right there, that's your stomach. So, and right here, you can see the vertebrae. okay? And you can see your belly muscles right here. So here is that lesser omentum, all right? Here, coming off the stomach like an apron, is that greater omentum. Now, what's really nice is you can see the strands of mesentery that are coming up and wrapping around the different parts of the intestines to anchor them. You can also see that the pancreas, part of the duodenum, are retroperitoneal, okay? Which means they don't have mesentery, all right, wrapped around it. So this is where you've got the parietal pericardium here. So they are embedded in that parietal pericardium in the back wall. So those are considered retroperitoneal. Okay. All right, so this is, again, another difficult slide, but a very important slide. So we've taken a piece of classic intestines and we've cut it. And so that you can see the transverse cut there, and then you can see kind of a coronal or a sagittal cut, probably a coronal cut right there. So you've got the lumen, which is the tube, and you can see that it's lined with a mucosa right there. And the mucosa is going to be the epithelium plus the lamina propria, and we're going to add a third layer. So one, two, three. We're going to add the muscularis mucosae, which is a super thin layer that you can barely see, okay? Layer number three is going to be the submucosa, so you can see it right up in here. All right, and then over here, I've got some examples of stuff that you're going to find in that submucosa. Tends to be a mix of areolar and dense irregular CTP, which if you remember from AMP1, there's not a whole lot of difference between the two other than areolar has thinner collagen fibers and dense irregular has thicker collagen fibers. All right, and then it's got a lot of glands, nerves, blood vessels, all that kind of stuff. All right, now the next layer is going to be here. So we're going from deep right here to superficial here, okay? Now the muscularis externa, we're going to add that to the name so that you do not get it confused with the muscularis mucosae. So please use the full name, muscularis externa. It's got three layers, circular, So there's only showing two layers here, sorry. The stomach is three layers. So we've got the circular, which is wrapping around it, and then the longitudinal, which is going down the length of it, okay? So the circular is good for segmentation movements, and the longitudinal is good for peristaltic contractions, which you should know, okay? Now you've got the serosa right here, and this is going to be visceral serosa, visceral peritoneum, okay? Now, look at the serosa here, and look at the serosa here. Do you see how they come together to form a sandwich? So that is your mesentery, okay? Now, most of the GI tract is gonna have the serosa. The exception is gonna be the esophagus, which is more of a fibrous adventitia, okay? So just a fibrous sheath. Okay, next slide. All right, so this is just a different view of the same thing, but I like the view because you can see a little bit better the epithelium and then the lamina propria there and then the muscularis mucosae here. And then this would be the submucosa, which I think is already labeled right there, so I won't redo it, okay? This arrow should actually be going to right there. Sometimes it doesn't work when I do these PDF transfers, okay? The muscularis externa, all right? So now you can see really nicely the longitudinal fibers. I don't know where my arrows went because they're gone. Oops, sorry. And then that's the circular, okay? And then this would be the serosa, or if you're dealing with the esophagus, the adventitia, which actually this looks like the esophagus, because this is stratified squamous epithelium. So yeah, this is a esophagus. All right, next slide. All right, let's dive deeper into the histology now. So we've got basically a nice generic alimentary canal, and what I wanna show you here is the mucosa versus the submucosa versus the muscularis externa versus the serosa, which is super thin. Okay, so you can see here is the epithelium. That is all lamina propria. Okay, and then we've got glands in here, which is this submucosa, which is, this looks like mostly an areolar CTP in here. Okay, and then this would be smooth muscle. Okay, let's move on. All right, so what we've done here with this slide from APR is we've taken the esophagus and done a transverse section through it. It's at low magnification. And the reason we want to do that is so that you can really clearly see the epithelium right here versus the lamina propria right there, okay? I am seeing nicely the muscularis mucosae here and here. So then this is all lamina propria, okay? Then superficial to the muscularis mucosae, I have my submucosa. And then this would be the muscularis externa, and then you've got your adventitia, okay? So what are you looking for here, all right? You are looking for color changes, all right? You are looking for texture changes. You are looking for the lumen of the tube. So this is the lumen, okay? And then you just kind of practice doing these as you're trying to identify them. All right, so this is also from APR, and this is a fun slide because you're seeing the gastroesophageal junction. And what's really, really cool is that the epithelium changes because the function changes. So here is the esophagus side, and it is stratified squamous epithelium because you're eating tortilla chips and you're scratching your throat as you swallow it, and you don't want to bleed. So you've got all these epithelial cells there to resist abrasion, okay? And if you didn't take my AMP1 lab, please don't ever put that a cell protects something, because it's a really generic explanation. I want to know how it protects it. So stratified squamous epithelium protects it by resisting abrasion. If you're talking about the transitional epithelium in the bladder, it protects by providing lots of cells that can die due to the acidity of urine and be replaced quickly, okay? Now, over here, you see this dramatic change right there. That's the transition from the esophagus to the stomach. And you'll see the stomach is these simple columnar cells. Sometimes people call these goblet cells, although they technically really aren't goblet cells, because they're not shaped like goblet cells, but they are all mucus-secreting cells, which is why sometimes people call them goblet cells. Okay, all right, let's look at, oh, and then you got lamina propria there and lamina propria there. All right, next slide. All right, so let's look at your stomach. So you see right here, you've got your diaphragm muscle, okay? That creates this not true sphincter because it's made out of skeletal muscle. Okay, it responds to stretching, which is going to be a spinal reflex. You'll study, like, when do you study that? I think you do that in lecture class. Anyway, when the esophagus moves through, now you've got stomach, all right? The stomach we're going to divide into the fundus, which is the top, the body, which is the middle, and then the pylorus. And I would call just this section the pylorus, okay? Now, with the stomach, we've got a change in that we've got three layers of muscularis externa because this needs to work like a blender. So you've got longitudinal, circular, and oblique. Oblique means an angle, okay? Now, the stomach can go from being about the size of your fist to being about the size of a gallon of milk, okay? So it goes from being really tightly folded up to being really big. So when you fold it up, you get all these wrinkles, which are called rugae, okay? And you should know that. Now, at the base of the stomach, at the most distal end of the stomach, I have a swelling right here of smooth muscle, which creates a true sphincter because it is like a drawstring purse, all right? And that is called the pyloric sphincter. And that controls the amount of chyme that moves from the pylorus into the duodenum. Okay, next slide. So here we've just got a cadaver, and I've got everything labeled so that you can see the different parts. So you've got the fundus versus the body, and where's the label for the pylorus? I don't really like the way they've labeled pylorus, so I'll just do it for you. So that's the pylorus, okay? You can see some of the folds of the rugae, okay? What else can you see? You can see really nicely here in this picture the pyloric sphincter, all right? So you should be able to label that. All right, next slide. All right, so this is the last slide on this particular part, on part one of the digestive system, and we're looking at the histology of the stomach, okay? So this is the kind of picture you might get on a test. But in APR, they do this nice thing of highlighting so that you can see things a little bit better. So let's see, right here, I know I've got my simple squamous epithelium. Here, I know I've got my lamina propria, okay? And then all of this stuff is gonna be squeezed in, and then I've got more lamina propria in here. Now, with the way the stomach works, I've got glands that are going down, and so you'll see little pockets of lamina propria, but then you're gonna see epithelium from the glands. Now, these glands are the gastric glands, and you can see, I like this because it highlights them so you can see them. Now, the openings to the gastric glands are the gastric pits, okay? And then you can see the real openings is right here. Oh, and I'm sorry, I didn't see that coloration very well. So this would be lamina propria here, and that would be lamina propria here. And then right here, you see a little bit of strands of the muscularis mucosae, okay? Okay, which is nice because there it is labeled. This is why I like APR, is because it goes through and it highlights these things so you can practice trying to get your eyes to see them, okay? All right, that is the end of part one. Don't forget that in addition to being able to identify things, you need to be able to talk about their functions. So why is the stomach lined with a bunch of mucus-secreting simple columnar cells, okay? What is the function of the gastric glands, all right? And so forth. Okay, so I'm gonna stop there, and you can move on to part two.